Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Mr. Ashraf Omar, who will be connecting live with us virtually.
Good morning, the chairman and the members of the OPA. It is a privilege to address all of you today. As a country, we are blessed with a strategic location, a small and a very literate population, and our social indicators are comparable to the developed world. However, we have not been able to leverage these strengths to grow economically. One of the key reasons has been that we do not have enough entrepreneurs. Now, preparing for this address, I scanned various sectors and found that we have entrepreneurs that whom we can be proud of. Let me give you some examples. Now, in apparel, we are almost, say, we are above $5 billion in export. In per capita terms, we are among the top few countries who have that amount of export per capita. However, we still have a very large potential to grow much bigger. If you look at the profile of the industry, you will see that we have over 200 exporters. The top 15 account for about 60% of the total exports. While the big companies are catering to the international brands and specialty retailers, there are some smaller companies who supply to a very niche clientele. So these people are very capable and smart to get into those niche markets. Because we have 200 exporters, I believe even the smaller exporters and the smallest exporter might export only about $3 million. But if we encourage them to grow, then our top line as a country will grow because of that. And we need that type of exporter, small exporter becoming bigger. Now, when you look at tea, there are large exporters of bulk and bags. But there are some very famous brands, Dilma for instance, Akma for instance, there are brands like that. But there are a small group of very high-end exporters, for example, to the Japanese market. And also to the European market, very, very high end, very high priced. But I am sure none of you would have heard of them. Now let's move on to rubber. I am just scanning the few big things and then we will come to our suggestions. So in rubber, we have the bigger exporters. We have the largest exporter in the world for solid tires. We have gloves, we have so many other things. But again, among the total export group, there are smaller niche exporters who supply very high-end products to very technologically advanced companies. Jumping into coconut, of course, the traditional fiber, copra, all that is exported, but there is virgin coconut oil and there are coconut milk products which are exported again to very sophisticated markets. If we go on to fish, we have the normal bulk fish exports, but shrimps, crab and all that. So there are exporters doing all this type of product, horticulture, cosmetics. If you look at a company like Spa Ceylon, if you look at a company like Demro, which it's a pleasure when I sometimes drive around in India, I see Demro boards in various cities. So it's a pleasure to see a Sri Lankan company selling product there under their own brand name. Restaurants and bakery products. If you look at restaurants, we have some world-class restaurants here. And now some of them have, say, Ministry of Crab is in Mumbai and in Hong Kong. So we have, let me just finish with a few others. In IT, we have companies like Virtusa, who have done brilliantly. And then we have other smaller companies who do specific projects in the IT sector. During the pandemic, we saw hundreds of entrepreneurs growing because there was a need. So they used IT, they used services like PickMe, and they kept on making money and creating a market for products because they had the knowledge, they had the passion, they had the drive, and they grew up. So in every industry, we have entrepreneurs whom we can be proud of. The challenge is scale. The country needs many, many more of them. And how do we scale up? So that's the challenge. So in my beginning, I just wanted to show that we have what it takes. We have the people, we have everything, but the lack of a large scale of an entrepreneurial class is what we are missing. And I am sure that's the challenge that all of you are discussing today. So I have some suggestions. One is that we celebrate and recognize these entrepreneurs. Now today you see only the big guys, but not these specialists who are there, who are doing a fantastic job, but nobody knows that they are there. And I gave you just a few examples, but there are many, many more. Recently I was told that there is a company which supplies to the top end medical devices industry in the world. They export to Europe. Even I didn't know that till I went for a funeral, right? And somebody told me. So what I suggest is that we have to recognize what we do, and there are some companies that I think as a country, as a society, we can be proud of. This will inspire the youngsters to emulate these heroes who are there today. And we must invite these entrepreneurs to speak to budding youngsters, and they can learn from each other. Well, today I think the focus is very narrow, you know, it's only towards the few big companies. No, we have much better array of entrepreneurs who have to be sought out and celebrated. So that's one key thing that will change the whole image of entrepreneurship in this country. The second big one is access to funds. Now let me give you a story of myself. As a smaller manufacturer, years ago, I wanted to buy a generator. I can remember it was a 300 kVA Mitsubishi generator, and the price was 350,000 rupees. So I needed a loan. And I went to the DFCC and said that I want to apply for the loan. They gave me a big sheet of number of forms, I think it was 15 or 20 pages long, and you said you fill this. So I was a bit, because I had gone to my father and told him, will you give some property as a collateral? And he said, yeah, because you are starting off, I will do that. So I told this officer that, no, I don't need to fill all these forms. I have a property which is worth more than this. I can give that as a collateral. So she told me that we are not here to take collateral and give loans. We are here to develop entrepreneurs. So once you fill these forms properly, you will understand, and we will understand whether you are capable of making it successful and repaying it. So I had to sit and fill that form, and fortunately I got that loan. But it taught me a lot. I would have been 22, 23 years old at that time. So it taught me a lot that it's not only just to try and give some property, take a loan and then bust it up. You learn a lot. Now, unfortunately, we don't have development banks today, and they have to be there to bring up the smaller entrepreneur. So how do we do that? I think as a society, as a business community, as a professional community, we have to get together and sit with the powers that be and try to come up with a plan so that the young entrepreneurs are brought into the fold, and they might, some might fail, and that's the rule of entrepreneurship. You see, everybody won't succeed. So they have to be, but if they fail, they cannot lose their house and whatever property they had, right? They should have that safety. The next one, the number three on my list, is exposure. Now, personally, I have learned a lot by going on visits overseas, visiting different countries, different markets, at that time through the Export Development Board. They still have that program, but now it has to be expanded for entrepreneurship. If we go and visit factories in India, in China, in Taiwan, our entrepreneurs will learn a lot. But right now we have another advantage. Because of the pandemic, everything we are doing, including this meeting, is virtual. So I have had some of our teams visiting other factories virtually. So it doesn't cost anything. You don't have to leave your office or house, and still you get that exposure. So we have to have your organization or your membership should have that exposure visits to companies which make sense and those who allow. So bigger companies are generally much more open to smaller companies coming and looking at their processes, their manufacturing processes, etc. There can be a lot of knowledge gained from them. If you look at our infrastructure today, the vocational training facilities in this country, there are many and they are very good quality. Unfortunately, they are not used as much as they should be. They are being used and they are doing some good work. But in my view, the need that we have for young entrepreneurs coming up, we will need to give training in different aspects. There can be a small plumbing company. So 5 young kids can be great plumbers and they can do the vocational training. So we should be running our vocational training institutes 24/7. Right, that should be the demand. But that the government doesn't have to do or won't do. It is the business community and the professionals who have to do it. Because whenever you contact the vocational training institutes, they are eager to support. But they lack some resources which we can bring in and create a pipeline of talented people in different sectors. Then you look at markets. In the beginning, I told you we are blessed by our geographical location. Now we are next to a market which is huge, right? So it's no point being just focusing on the Sri Lankan market because it's small, right? We are 20 million people, right? That is lesser people than in the whole of Mumbai. So look at the I used to be thrilled a few years ago when I land in Mumbai and when I'm going to the hotel, I see Sanat Jaya Surya or Malingas, big billboards, right? So they have captured that market, right? As stars, they can go and play in professional games and so many other cricketers. Now, you look at the latest example of Yohani, right? She hit it on the YouTube. She could have waited here, but she went to India, right? To Hyderabad and to Mumbai. Now she has a market, right? So why should we just focus ourselves with 20 million people when we have 1.2, 1.3 billion people to sell to? So that thinking also has to be ingrained into our people. Like I gave the example of a couple of Sri Lankan companies who have done that, but it has to be more and more to export. Now, one would argue from where would we bring these people? I'll give you some numbers and I am not sure whether they are the latest numbers, but these were the numbers when I have been working on a couple of years ago. We have almost 500,000 children sitting for the O levels every year. And out of that, about 300,000 go on to sit for the A levels. Out of that, about 80,000 qualify pass the A level also. About 20,000 go to the universities. Another 15,000-20,000 might be doing courses like SEMA and the other overseas universities. But what happens to that 500,000 kids who started at the O level? All of them are there. They can be fantastic entrepreneurs. But if the vocational training, if the development banks, and if organizations such as yours get together and say that we will tap that, otherwise they will just go and do some menial work or go to Dubai or some country and do some very, we have almost 1 million women working in the Middle East as housemaids, right? Now those 1 million women, even if 100,000 of them are trained, funded, they can be running salons, they can be running manufacturing, they can be running horticulture. There are immense potential to grow with our, so I think as a community, as a an organization, right, you are easily the most influential organization in this country. So my suggestion is, let's all get together, right? I think Dulita, you have taken a good initiative to get this entrepreneurship going. But my request is, put some metrics. How are you going to measure that from today, same time next year, that the entrepreneurship movement has grown, right? Even 5 new entrepreneurs have come in, right? How do we do that? So if we hold ourselves accountable, these 500 kids who sit for the O level, because our educational policies have still were designed to create people who can come and work in government or in an office, right? Not go out and do different stuff. So same thing with me, same thing for all of you, right? We came, you somehow get through the O level. In my case, after A level, I stopped, right? So I didn't go to do a degree, right? But even if you do a degree, you're looking for a government job, right? Why? Because you're scared that there is, if you have a government job, at least you have a pension and you have job security. In the private sector, you don't have that. As an entrepreneur, you don't have anything, right? You start something and if it fails, you have nothing. So we have to create that safety net, right? Create that confidence in our young folks to venture out there, try. If it succeeds, fine. If it fails, doesn't matter, it's not death, right? If it fails, you come up again. So ladies and gentlemen, it has been a privilege talking to you, and I hope that this current initiative on driving entrepreneurship is followed through and there is a regular cadence set up so that you look at it quarterly or half yearly or yearly to see whether the needle has moved and more entrepreneurs are coming in. So thank you very much for inviting me, and I hope I have not bored you too much. Thank you.